Hi, welcome back to the Go Draft. I'm Andy Guerdat. We are discussing my techniques on film and television writing. And we are specifically now discussing scenes and how to attack the writing of a scene for cinema. I don't know why it is. I read a lot of scripts, a lot of screenplays, a lot of television scripts, and mostly by people in their 20s and 30s. And for some reason, most of the people who are writing these scenes, even though they rarely go to the live theater, to the legitimate theater, occasionally, but they don't regularly go, but they've seen thousands and thousands of hours of movies and television and YouTube videos and TikTok videos. Yet, when they sit down to write their own original scene for a screenplay or television or whatever, they default to playwriting. And by that I mean I read a lot of scripts that start this way. Interior apartment, night, Bob is making himself a drink, Jennifer enters, talk, 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 rising conflict, Jennifer leaves. Cut to exterior park bench, day, Denise sits eating lunch, Susan joins her, talk, 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 then Susan leaves. Cut to interior restaurant, night, Jim is reading the menu, Carol enters and joins him, talk, 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 I love you too, they leave. Into your bedroom, night, Jim and Carol are finished making love, Jim rolls off of Carol, talk, 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 Carol gets up and goes to the bathroom. That's theater. Those are theater scenes. Those are scenes that could have been done for the live theater. They're not screenwriting scenes, screen-written scenes. It doesn't mean in screenwriting you can't set a scene in an apartment. Of course you can. And it doesn't mean you can't have your characters talk. Of course you can. But what it does mean, if that's all you're doing, you're not using the power of cinema. You are not using the tools that cinema has given you to tell a story in a particular and specific and powerful way. You're like an electrician who showed up at a job site with a toilet plunger. You brought the wrong toolbox. So let's take a scene that could be done for the theater and then see how it might look as a film scene. So here we are. We're in a live theater together. We're sitting in the third row. The curtain parts and the set is the interior of a bar, like an upscale bar in Manhattan. And we see some attractive people at the tables downstage. Upstage, we see a bar, like a counter, and there's a guy, a good-looking guy, well-dressed, sitting alone at the bar. The door opens, and in comes a man and a woman. And there we discover from their dialogue that she's a single woman, straight woman, and he's a single gay man. And we can tell this because they're talking about how their boyfriends left them or something. They sit at a table, and she glances back at the bar, and she sees the good-looking guy sitting there, and he kind of glances in their direction, and she turns to her friend, and she says, "Hey, do me a favor. I want you to act really gay." And he says, "What are you talking about?" She says, I want that guy to know we're not a couple, so act really gay, kind of go over the top, so he knows that we're not together that way. And her friend says, "That's really stupid. That's really high school. I don't want to do that." And she talks him into it. "Please, please, please." Finally, she talks him into it, and he agrees. And he starts to speak very flamboyantly about, you know, Broadway show tunes and fashion. And he snaps his fingers at the cocktail waitress and orders two very frou-frou-sounding drinks, you know, two Singapore slings or something like that. As he's doing this, the guy at the bar looks over, he sees them, he sort of smiles, he gets up, he starts to walk toward them. The woman says, "Okay, it worked, and he approaches them and he hits on the guy, right? And he sits down next to the guy and they start talking and they hit it off, and the woman slumps in disappointment. Okay, end of scene. Theater scene, right? That's something you could see in a play. Now let's take that very same scene and let's do it as a film scene. Let's say I have to adapt it for the movies. How might I do it? Well, first thing off, I don't have to start inside the bar, do I? It's a movie. I can start exterior city street, Manhattan, right? And I can see my protagonist, let's assume is the woman, walking down the street with her gay male friend, and we can have them talking about the same subject matter, or I could have a good-looking guy in tight jeans walk past them going the other direction, and they both stop and they both eyeball them and give each other a look like, oh yeah, I'd tap that. And they continue walking on. They could be talking about their boyfriends having left them, but they could be talking about something else because I have visually now established that he's gay, she's straight, and they're both interested. They go into the bar. Now I cut inside the bar. They take a seat at a table, and in the background of this of our frame, we can see the guy at the bar, the good-looking guy at the bar, and the director could choose to rack focus to look at him more clearly, or he could just or she could just frame the shot so that the eye of the audience is looking at notices the guy in the background more. She glances back. We could go to a close-up if we wanted to see her looking at him. We could even go to a point-of-view shot if we wanted to, a point-of-view shot of the guy at the bar, if the director so chose. And she turns back to her friend. She says, I want you to act really gay for the same reasons we just described. He says, I don't want to do that. That's really high school. She says, please, please, please. And now I cut, and I cut to a close-up of a tray, a cocktail waitress's tray with two drinks on it, and they're both pink, and they've got little paper umbrellas and spears with pineapple chunks and cherries and stuff. And the waitress sets it down in front of them, sets the drinks down, they start to sip them. She glances back. Sure enough, the guy at the bar has noticed, and he gets up and he starts to walk toward them. And I cut to exterior bar, the door opens, the two guys walk out together, chatting away, having a great time. They turn and walk off down the street. I hold on the bar door as it opens again, and now the woman steps out all alone. She looks at them walking down the street, turns the other direction, and walks away. Okay, I just did the same scene, but I used cinematic techniques to tell that story. In theater, your job is to motivate the characters on stage to start talking. In film, your job is to motivate the characters to shut up and get going. I say this as someone who has written for the stage many times, both as a produced playwright, but also when I was writing multi-camera sitcoms, which are essentially a form of playwriting, and I did it for 20 years. But I've also written movies and lots of animation and TV movies and hour-long dramas, all of which are filmic rather than playwriting. So I've done both. In a film, when you're doing cinema, when you are screenwriting in any of its many forms, you want to move the story along as fast as comfortable. You want to start the scene as late as possible, and you want to end it as soon as possible. As soon as the unit of information you set out to communicate has been communicated, you want to get out of there. It's a motion picture. It's supposed to be moving. The only time you might want to let a scene go on past the obvious point where the point of the scene has been made, the only time you might want to do that is for comic effect. The Coen brothers do that quite often. Here's an example of doing that from Fargo.
How are you doing?
Mr. Mora?
Yeah.
Officer Olson?
Yeah, righto. Well, so I'm tending bar down there at Eklund and Swedland's last Tuesday, and this little guy's drinking, and he says, so where can a guy find some action? I'm going crazy out there at the lake. And I says, what kind of action? And he says, woman action. What do I look like? And I says, well, what do I look like? I don't arrange that kind of thing. And he says, but I'm going crazy out there at the lake. And I says, yeah, but this ain't that kind of place.
Uh-huh.
He says, oh, so I get it. So you think I'm some kind of jerk for asking, only you don't use the word jerk.
I understand.
Then he calls me a jerk, says, last guy thought he's a jerk is dead now. So I don't say nothing. He says, what do you think about that? And I says, well, that don't sound like too good a deal for him then.
You got that right.
Yeah. He says, yeah, that guy's dead, and I don't mean of old age. And then he says, geez, I'm going crazy out there at the lake.
White Bear Lake?
Yeah, well, at Eklund and Swedland, that's closer to Moose Lake, so I made that assumption.
Oh, sure.
Anyway, he's drinking at the bar, so I don't think a whole great deal of it. But then Mrs. Mora, she heard about the homicides down here and thought I should call it in, so I called it in. End of story.
Well, what this guy look like, anyways?
Oh, he's a little guy, kind of funny looking.
Uh-huh. In what way?
Oh, just in a general kind of way.
Okay. Well, thanks a bunch, Mr. Mora. You're right. It's probably nothing. But thanks for calling her in.
Sure. Looks like she's gonna turn cold tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. Got a front coming in.
Yeah, you got that right.
So movies, motion pictures, are supposed to move. They are a temporal art form. That is to say, movies and television, film in general, exists in time, not space. A painting, a sculpture, an artwork of architecture, all exist in space, not time. The recipient of the art form can look at it as long as they want or as short as they want. That doesn't affect the way the work of art is appreciated. The same, to some degree, is true of literature, in fact, even though it does obviously take time to read a story or a novel. You can read it as slow or as fast as you wish. You can reread a sentence. You can reread a chapter. You can reread a paragraph. You can skim over a chapter, as many people do. And when they read Moby Dick, they skim over the chapters about whaling techniques. So literature exists in both time and space. But film exists in time. And the audience wants that time to move. So when you're writing excess junk in order to justify the characters getting from here to there, explain how this happened to that happened, and it's not really necessary, you can cut it now when it's free, or you can wait until the line producer comes to you and says, really, do you want to spend $10,000 extra on this restaurant scene or $100,000 on this restaurant scene? How important is it to you? Because we're over budget. You're going to have to cut something. And then you can cut it. Or worst of all, you can wait until the whole film's been shot and you've gone way over budget and you spent 5 days shooting a restaurant scene you don't really need. And then you can sit in an editing bay and weep as you cut this thing because the film is just moving too slow. Almost nobody ever sits in an editing bay and says, God, this movie is moving along so fast, I wish we could slow it down. It's almost always the other way around. I used to work for an executive producer on Head of the Class, a television show, and it was my job as the supervising producer to keep scripts in front of him, in the production pipeline, and he would pick them up, and because he was in charge of editing, he would pick up the script for next week with a red pencil and oftentimes just cross out the first two pages without reading them or barely reading them, because he knew that the writers had done a beautiful, subtle, elegant job of gracefully getting into the story, and he knew he was going to sit in the editing bay and just cut it anyway, so I might as well cut it when it's on paper. Woody Allen directed, I think, like six people to Academy Award actors to Academy Awards, something like 18 nominations or something like that. And somebody asked him, what's the trick to getting a great performance? And he said, there's only two things. One is cast it right and then let them do what they want. And the only other direction I ever give is faster. Could you please do that faster? Could you say it faster? Could you get across the room faster? So you want to use the tools of cinema, not the tools of stage, when you sit down to attack a scene. And what are the tools of cinema? What are the things that we can do in film that we cannot do on stage? What are they? Let's make a list together. Well, the first one is when people, up until around the turn of the prior century, when film became a legitimate art form that people are at least exploring. Until that point, every piece of dramatic art that anyone had ever experienced was the live theater. And when you do theater, you're bringing the characters on stage and off stage, right? And usually from the side, from the wings, stage right, stage left. They come on, they start trying. Occasionally you might bring one in from upstage, but even then it's only a few feet upstage because a theater can only be so deep. In film, you don't have to do that. You can bring people into the action from almost anywhere. So you have depth of field. Theater doesn't have that. Theater is linear. But cinema has depth of field. Now, this was an original concept, because remember, nobody had ever seen, you couldn't do that in theater, so it had to be discovered, had to be figured out. So the early filmmakers, people like D.W. Griffith, started to play around with this concept, and here's a clip from a short film he directed, I imagine he wrote it too, I don't know, called Red Man's View. It's a very weird little film because it's a very sympathetic short film about Native peoples, made in 1909, no less, and made by the guy who made perhaps the most racist movie ever made, which was Birth of a Nation, and yet he made a very sympathetic little story here. That's kind of irrelevant to what we're talking about. We're talking about depth of field. So watch how, in this very crude way, he uses depth of field. Okay, that's a very crude scene from 1909, but in its own way, it's more sophisticated than many of the scenes that I read for modern films, or watch, for that matter, in modern films, when it's nothing but two people standing in a kitchen talking. In this case, D.W. Griffith figured out, if I bring in that character, the male character, from the background to the foreground, it will create suspense. I have a pretty woman kneeling by a stream, washing her face. I bring the man in from the background to the foreground. She doesn't see him. The audience instinctively tenses up. There's instinctive suspense. What's he going to do? And then she turns and smiles at him. He turns and he looks down and smiles at her. We realize they know each other and like each other, and the tension is relieved. That's a more sophisticated scene than blah, 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 blah. Now, depth of field was then, let's go 50 years or so into the future, and now the great director David Lean, working from a great script by Michael Wilson and Robert Bolt, made this scene from Lawrence of Arabia perhaps the best use of depth of field in the history of cinema. And all you need to know is that Lawrence, the young British officer, is making his way into the desert, being guided by a Bedouin Arab, and they stop at a well in the middle of the desert, and they're getting water, and they look up and they see a speck on the horizon, and this happens.
Bedouin. Who is he? Tapas!
By slowly bringing that dot on the horizon closer and closer and closer, it creates enormous suspense. And in his case, he didn't relieve the suspense by having them smile at each other. He relieved it when the speck on the horizon shoots one of them dead. It was an incredibly powerful moment, and it was a great way of introducing a major character. It created enormous instinctive suspense to use depth of field that way. Likewise, when you reverse it, when you have a character move away from the camera, it also has an emotional effect on the audience. It creates a sense of loss, of diminishment, of weakness, of weakened power. Here's an example from a movie called The Three Godfathers that John Ford directed. It's not a great movie, but it has some great moments in it, and this is one of them. It's all you have to know is that these are three outlaws are escaping across the desert. They stumble upon a wagon, a pioneer wagon, and the the family inside have drunk accidentally, and their horses have drunk from a poisoned toxic well or watering hole, and are all dead except for a baby. And the three outlaws try to get the baby across the desert, and one by one the outlaws die in this attempt. And here's the scene where the second of the outlaws is about to die. He's been given he's been wounded and injured. He can't go on. The last outlaw, played by John Wayne, gives him a gun, and theoretically to protect himself, but we know he's probably going to use it for something else. And then John Wayne, with the baby, walks away, and this is what happens.
En los cielos, hazte un campito en tu santo reino, a este pobre de Pedro.
So by showing Wayne walk away from camera, John Ford, the director, created that sense of diminishment, of weakness. Is he even have a chance of making it all the way across the desert? That's what he wants you to feel, clutching this little baby as he walks away from camera, not toward it, not sideways, away from camera. What else can we do in cinema that we can't do in theater? We can put the camera anywhere. We can make the audience look at whatever we want them to. Here's a great example from a great movie called Notorious, which was directed by Alfred Hitchcock and written by Ben Hecht, who may have been the greatest screenwriter in history. Watch how these filmmakers make you look at what they want you to look at. Now he makes us look at a grand ballroom with a party going on, and he pushes the camera all the way down to the hand of the protagonist, the woman, and we see in her hand she's clutching a key, which is a key she's going to have to slip to her lover during the course of this party. You can't do that in theater. Yes, a theater director can direct your attention, the attention of the audience, stage right or stage left, using lighting and blocking of the actors and so on, but it's very limited compared to that. A director in theater cannot make you see a tiny little key in somebody's hand. It's very, very hard to do, and it certainly wouldn't be anywhere near as effective as that was. Here's another example of it. You can put the camera anywhere you want. And this is from 1903, mind you. This is from The Great Train Robbery, which was one of the most popular of the early narrative films ever made. Look at this shot. Now, in 1903, when audiences saw that shot, they screamed and fell to the floor. And the reason was, no one had ever seen that and lived to tell about it. It was the first time ever. They just naturally assumed the bullet was coming for them. You can put the camera in all kinds of interesting places. And with CGI, of course, you literally can put it anywhere. The metaphorical camera, anyway. It's something you're going to know that you have that tool in your toolbox. What else can we do that theater cannot do? We can speed up time. Max Sennett and many of the early filmmakers learned, and many filmmakers since them have also learned, that by speeding up the action, you enhance the comedy, like this. Or you can speed up time for other effects, and here's another example of speeding up time.
Come to offer my sincere condolences. My dear Colonel Duval, I don't think you should have opened that car door by yourself.
Dressed man should be the first one.
Yes, very practical.
Get inside. Hurry.
Get me.
Jump cuts in that fight scene, which were revolutionary at the time, it was really the James Bond movies, I think, that kind of invented that effect, and now it's used all the time when we jump cut in the course of the fight scenes in order to enhance the sense of propulsive action. It's going faster than it normally would. The characters get across the room faster than they possibly could, and it makes the action seem more powerful and more propulsive. It's like an adrenaline rush. We can also, in cinema, slow down time, like this.
Thank you.
So by slowing down the action that way, the director Sergio Leone created an incredible sense of suspense. He milked it for everything it was worth, and then a little bit beyond that. Here's another example of slowing down time, also from a James Bond movie. We saw in Thunderball, we saw him speed up time. This is the climax of Goldfinger. So did you notice, I mean, you probably didn't, there's no reason why you should have, but I timed it. The time it took for the clock, the timer on the bomb, to get from 25 seconds to 19 seconds was 13 seconds. The time it took for it to get from 12 seconds to 9 seconds was 7 seconds. And the time it took for it to get from 9 seconds to 7 seconds was 4 seconds. And of course, ending on 007, which is one of the great visual jokes of all time. When that audience in the theater saw, they stopped the bomb at 007. They just burst out laughing. It was so clever. Obviously, again, slowing down time to milk every bit of suspense out of that climactic scene as they possibly could. What else can we do in cinema that we cannot do in theater? We can pick up the audience and move them anywhere. And here's a classic example. So Stanley Kubrick and Arthur C. Clarke just picked you up and moved you from a close shot of a bone to 7 million years later and a wide shot of a spaceship. And they did it all in a cut, as you just saw. And that's another thing that we can do, perhaps the most important thing that we can do in cinema that you cannot do in theater, and that is cut. The cut may be the most powerful tool you have in your toolbox, and it certainly is the one, from my experience, that is used the least and used the least effectively by most screenwriters. And probably it's because they think the cutting of the film is the director's tool or the editor's tool. And yes, they do have the final say on what we're cutting to and from. But by no means is it only their device to be used. It's your device. You're the first filmmaker. If you leave it up to them to figure out what we're cutting to and from, you're going to be very disappointed. Sometimes they'll come up with something, but most of the time they will not. If it's not in the script, it probably won't wind up on the screen. So you need to think about what you're cutting to. You want to, in fact, write to the cut. What do I mean by that? It means you need to know what you're cutting to before you start writing the scene. Here's some examples from great screenwriters working with great directors. First one is from Tootsie.
Michael, he's tied up right now. I swear.
Hang on one second. Michael, would you wait outside, please? I'm talking to the coast.
This is a coast too, George. New York is a coast too.
Oh, boy.
Sigh, God, look what you... Margaret, get him back, will you? I cut myself off.
Now, what is it, Michael?
Terry Bishop is doing Iceman Cometh, right? Didn't you promise to send me up for that part? Am I wrong? Didn't you tell me I was gonna get a reading for
Michael,
that part? Aren't you my agent,
Stuart
too?
Stuart Pressman wants a name, Michael.
Oh, I see. Terry Bishop is a name.
No. Michael Dorsey is a name. When you want to send a steak back, Michael Dorsey is a name.
Okay.
Wait. You always do this to me. It was a rotten thing to say, and I know it. Let me start all over again. Terry Bishop is on a soap opera. Millions of people watch him every day. He's known.
And that qualifies him to ruin Iceman Cometh? You know, I can act circles around that guy. I already played that part
Stuart
in Minneapolis.
Stuart Pressman wants a name. That's his affair, okay? I know this is going to disgust you, Michael, but a lot of people are in this business to make money.
Well, don't make me out like I'm some flake, George. I am in this business to make money, too.
Really?
Yes.
Harlem Theater for the Blind, Strindberg in the Park, the People's Workshop in Syracuse.
Okay, now, wait a minute. I did 9 plays in 8 months up at Syracuse. I happened to get great reviews from the New York critics. Not that that's why I did it.
Well, of course not. God forbid you should lose your standing as a cult failure.
You think I'm a failure, George? Is that what you're saying to me?
I will not get sucked into this conversation, Michael. Okay. I will not.
Okay, look, I sent you a play to read that my roommate wrote. It had a great part in it for me. Did you read it?
Where the hell do you come off sending me your roommate's play for you to star in? I'm your agent, not your mother. I'm not supposed to find plays for you to star in. I'm supposed to field offers, and that's what I do.
Field offers? Who told you that? The agent fairy? That was a significant piece of work. I could have been terrific in that
play. Michael, nobody's going to do that play.
Why?
Because it's a downer, that's why. Because nobody wants to produce a play about a couple that moved back to Love Canal.
But that actually happened.
Who gives a shit? Nobody wants to pay $20 to watch people living next to chemical waste. They can see that in New Jersey.
Look, I don't want to argue about it, okay? I'm going to raise the $8,000 myself so I can produce his play, and I want you to send me up for anything. I don't care what it is. I will do dog commercials on television. I will do radio voiceovers.
Michael, I can't put you up for any of that.
Why not?
Because no one will hire you.
Oh, that's not true, man. I bust my ass to get a part right, and you know I do.
Yes, and you bust everybody else's ass, too. That's what you do. A guy's got 4 weeks to put on a play. You think he wants to sit and argue about whether or not Tolstoy can walk when he's dying or walk when he's talking or sing
when
he's
walking?
Oh, please,
that was 2 years ago, and that guy is an idiot.
Can't all be idiots, Michael. You argue with everybody. You've got one of the worst reputations in this town, Michael. Nobody will hire you.
Are you saying that nobody in New York will work with me?
Oh, no, that's too limiting. Nobody in Hollywood wants to work with you either. I can't even send you up for a commercial. You played a tomato for 30 seconds. They want a half a day over schedule because you wouldn't sit down.
Yes, it wasn't logical.
You were a tomato! A tomato doesn't have logic! A tomato can't move!
That's what I said. So if he can't move, how's he gonna sit down, George? I was a stand-up tomato, a juicy, sexy beefsteak tomato. Nobody does vegetables like me. I did an evening of vegetables off Broadway. I did the best tomato, the best cucumber. I did an endive salad that knocked the critics on their ass.
Michael, I'm trying to stay calm here. You are a wonderful actor.
Thank you.
But you're too much trouble. Get some therapy.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to raise $8,000, and I'm going to do Jeff's play.
Michael, you're not going to raise 25 cents. No one will hire you.
Oh, yeah?
So that scene was building as a very long dialogue scene, but its purpose was to build to that cut. And I assure you, it was the screenwriter, which was probably Larry Gelbart. There were many writers who worked on it, but it was probably Larry Gelbart who figured out how to do that scene, this critically important scene, because it's a scene in which this male character played by Dustin Hoffman is going to transform himself into a woman in order to get work. And that the entire dialogue scene's purpose was so that his agent, played by Sidney Pollack, the director, could say 4 times, no one will hire you. 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 And then finally, oh, yeah? And then cut to him walking down the street in women's clothing because he's going to transform himself into a woman so that he can get work. All done in a cut. We didn't have to see how he did it. We didn't have to see him go to shopping at the women's clothing stores. We didn't have to see him asking anyone's advice. We just did it in a cut. Here's another example of what you can do with a cut. And this one is, again, from Lawrence of Arabia. And it's a very famous cut. see a close-up of Lawrence holding a match, a lit match, going down right to his fingertips, and then he playfully blows it out just before it burns him, and we cut to the desert in the morning as the sun rises. Now, what does the cut tell us? It tells us, well, for one thing, he's gone from inside somebody's office in Cairo to the desert. We didn't need to see him get on a train. We didn't need to see him get a boat. We didn't need to see any. We know he's there. We got it. He's there. That's one thing. The other thing it does is it says, more subtly, I grant you, that Lawrence, who is playing with fire and thinks it's going to be fun to go into the desert, he's playing with fire, and from this moment on, fire is going to play with him, the big fire in the sky. An incredibly powerful cut. Here's another cut. This time it's the Coen brothers in Barton Fink. This is the tail end of a scene in which he's just had a John Turturro plays a character named Barton Fink, who's a New York playwright who's just had a triumphant success on Broadway, and his agent has called him into a bar and has just told him Hollywood wants to pay you a lot of money to come out there and be a screenwriter. And Barton Fink says, oh, no, I'm a playwright, I'm too good for that. And his agent gradually talks him into it, and this is the cut out of the scene. So what does that cut tell you? He's wearing a tuxedo. He's inside a bar. He's just hasn't quite agreed to go out to Hollywood. And we cut to, wham, a wave smashes into a rock in the Pacific Ocean. And what do you take away from that? Is all going to go well for Barton? Oh, no. Now, if they just cut to him driving into a studio, right, you'd think, well, I guess this is just going to, everything's going to go well. But by cutting to a rock in the ocean as a wave smashes into it, they are telling us, hang in there, things aren't going to go well for Barton Fink. Here's another example, perhaps it's definitely an example worthy of study. And it's from a movie called Lolita, which was the novel was written by Vladimir Nabokov, who got credit for the script, but the script was probably heavily rewritten by Stanley Kubrick. We don't know for sure. At any rate, it was directed by Stanley Kubrick. And watch the cut. Let's just watch the scene, and then we'll do a little exercise.
That's where we have our informal meals. My pastries win prizes around
perhaps
here.
If you'd let me have your telephone number, that would give me a chance to think it over.
1776.
1776, Declaration of Independence.
Yeah, so easy to remember. Oh, you must see the garden before you go. You must. My flowers win prizes around here. They're the talk of the neighborhood. Voila! My yellow roses, my daughter. Darling, turn that down, please. I can offer you a comfortable home, a sunny garden, a congenial atmosphere, my cherry pies.
Well, we haven't discussed how much.
Oh, something nominal, let's say 200 a month.
Yes, that's very...
Including meals and late snacks, yes. Etc.
That's very reasonable. Well, it's very nice.
You couldn't find better value in West Ramsdale.
No, well, when would it be convenient for you to have me move in?
Well, right now. I mean, it would be silly for you to go to a hotel, monsieur.
I've got my bags and the taxi. You're a very persuasive salesman, Mrs.
Thank you. What was the decisive factor? My garden?
I think it was your cherry pies.
Oh. Okay. She says, what was the deciding factor? We know he can't take his eyes off that gorgeous young teenage girl. And then when he registers how inappropriate that is, he looks away and never looks at anything else. But so we sense he's thinking about the teenage girl, and he says that little sort of inappropriate joke about, I think it was your cherry pie, right? Okay. Now, if you haven't seen the movie, and probably these days most people haven't, What would you assume the cut would be? What would Cooper cut to from that line? Would he cut to a shot of the middle-aged guy moving into the house? Would he cut to a shot of him unpacking his bag? And maybe we see the teenage girl walking by his open door and he gives her a little look. That's, those things seem logical, right? Here's what Kubrick cut to from what we just saw. Now, what does that cut mean? Your cherry pie. The teenage girl kind of smiles up at him, and we cut to a monster. And then cut back wide to reveal that these three people are watching a drive-in, a monster movie at a drive-in movie theater. What does that cut tell you? What do you feel when that cut happens? What does that do? It tells you don't get comfortable. It tells you this is going to be, in its own way, a monster movie. It tells you that that middle-aged man gawking at that teenage girl is a monster. And what happens to monsters? They kill and then they die. This is going to get dark. Don't get comfortable. Now, had he cut like 1,000 other filmmakers would have, had he just cut to, the middle-aged guy moving in, right? Like, you know, the birds are singing, it's sunny outside and he's moving in. The cut would have also said something, but it would have said, oh, this is going to be easy. This is going to be lazy. This is going to be kind of a calm, easygoing sexual romp where we get to leer at a teenage girl and do a lot of naughty jokes. It would have made a statement, but it would have been the wrong statement for what Kubrick wanted to do with this film, which is to tell a darkly comic story about a guy who does something monstrous. A scene is not over until it is juxtaposed against the beginning of the subsequent scene. That is the actual end of the scene. So that scene we just watched, Cherry Pie, that's not really the end of the scene. The end of the scene is the appearance of the monster. The juxtaposition of that tells us the completed information. Same way with the Tootsie scene. It's not over when he says, oh yeah. It's over when we cut to seeing him in the women's clothing walking down the street. The Lawrence scene is not over when he blows out the match. It's over when we see it juxtaposed with the desert, which says he's headed into the gigantic inferno of the desert. The scene is over only when it's juxtaposed with the image from the next subsequent scene. So, as a side note, you just saw in those few minutes from the movie Lolita, which is not even necessarily a great movie. I mean, it has great moments, but it's not one of my favorites. But you just saw in those few minutes almost everything you need to know about filmic storytelling, how to tell a story on film. Because what did you see? You saw, yes, the power of the cut, as we just discussed. You also saw the power of subtext, which we're going to get into in subsequent episodes very soon, because once we see him step out onto the porch and see Lolita, after that initial shock, what is the one thing he never looks at again in the scene? He never looks at her. Why? Because he's thinking about her. So they played the scene subtextually rather than just having him gawk at her throughout the entire scene. And then, of course, in the subsequent scene, after the cut to the monster, we see the three of them lined up in a drive-in movie in the front seat of a car. And here's an extraordinarily complex scene. It's a scene that shows the teenage girl is kind of interested in the middle-aged man, but only in kind of a silly, flirtatious way. Her mother, the age-appropriate middle-aged woman, is very interested in the middle-aged man and not at all in an innocent way. And the middle-aged man is not remotely interested in the mother, but he's very interested in the daughter. And we saw all of that just by using their hands. No dialogue. And if that's not enough, at the end of the scene, once they all realize there's something kind of weird about all this hand business, they all go like this, right? Because they're guilty. Because they all know something weird is going on here. All of that communicated without a word of dialogue. Pretty amazing. You should go back and look at it as often as you want to see a master filmmaker telling a story visually. Back to now to juxtaposing images. And the idea that every time you juxtapose an image, you create a third emotion. If I show you an image, you have an emotion. If I show you another image, you have another emotion. If I juxtapose them together, you have a third phantom emotion. I'll give you an example. Look at this clip. Okay, you probably responded, oh, it's so cute, such a sweet little kitty. Okay, now I could also show you separately this clip. Okay, a bright red sports car going super fast down the street. Wow, isn't that cool? Isn't that sexy? Isn't that hot? But if I show you the clip of the kitty and I juxtapose it, edit it, cut it, so that it's right up against the image of the red sports car zooming down the street, most people are going to think, oh no, maybe the sports car is going to hit the sweet little kitty, and they now have a third emotion, dread. So you went from, oh, isn't that cute, to, wow, that's really sexy, to, oh no, maybe the cat's going to get squished. Every time you juxtapose two images, no matter what they are, you create that emotional response every time, not once in a while, not when you think of something, not when you feel like it, every time. But the problem is most modern filmmakers, because they have not learned to appreciate the power of the cut, when they do use the cut, the emotion that they're creating is boredom or confusion. Periodically, constantly, some filmmaker tries to make a surrealist film in which it's anti-story, anti-narrative. I'm not going to allow the audience the comfort of a story. I'm just going to show them images, and they're just going to be, their minds will be freed up, and they'll just have to absorb the images, and I'm not going to give them a story. And it never works. At least for most people, it doesn't work. I guess if you're high enough, it can work. But then the Academy Award in those cases should go not to the filmmaker, but to the drug dealer. Most of the time, almost all the time, what happens is an audience looks at these random images, and they can be absolutely random, and they start making connections, whether the filmmaker intended them to or not. I shot this, I went on a random image generator online, and it showed me first an image of the interior of a beautiful, elaborate cathedral, and then the next random image it threw up was an image of a crow. So, okay, you juxtapose those two images. If that's the beginning of a movie and I see the interior of a cathedral and then I cut to a crow, I'm thinking, oh no, did the crow get in the cathedral? What's going to happen? Oh, that's going to be really inappropriate. Or maybe I'm thinking, is the crow on top of the cathedral watching people go in, and the crow is a symbol of doom? The point is, the audience, me in this case, but any audience, is going to make a connection. They're going to have to. Your brain can't not do it. And then when you string together 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of those unrelated images, what happens is the audience finally gets bored. It doesn't take too long because, yes, there is a story. They're making it up in their head, whether you wanted them to or not. It's just an incredibly bad story. And they get bored and they get tired of doing it, doing the filmmaker's storyteller's work for him. And then they get mad that they wasted their time and, God forbid, even their money on this piece of junk. You want to make sure then that you, the first filmmaker, are using those cuts to their maximum power so that they're doing what you want them to do, so that they're advancing the emotional through line of the story the way you want it to. Can the director change it afterwards, or the editor? Absolutely, but at least you're giving them something to start with that works, that makes sense. And surprisingly, I would say much of the time, if not most of the time, they will use those images, or at least something like that, like them, because it will inspire them to make use of their cuts instead of just making the cuts kind of random. Like, for example, if we cut from interior apartment to interior apartment to interior apartment to interior apartment, those cuts are telling us something. They're telling us that this is a really boring story. It's a boring world I'm entering, where everybody just stands around in their apartments and nothing. There's no juice to this world. It's boring. You will see very often now, especially in limited series on television, you'll see a scene, interior apartment, blah, 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 and then they'll cut to a drone shot of, if it's set in Los Angeles, a shot of Los Angeles at night, or if it's set in Montana, rural Montana, shots of, you know, the landscape of Montana. And then they cut back into another house or apartment or restaurant or office and blah, 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 blah. Well, those drone shots are telling us something. It's just not what the filmmaker usually wants. And what they're saying is, even though you may have seen something terribly dramatic going on in the prior scene, as soon as I cut to a drone shot, let's say it's a scene from Bosch, which was a perfectly acceptable series, still is, I guess, but did this a lot. So we're doing a tense scene with the detective, right? Cop show. Tough detective confronting a criminal, blah, blah, blah. And we cut to a drone shot, as they often did, of Los Angeles at night. And we see the freeways and the cars and everything. Okay, what that says to the audience subliminally is everything's okay. Los Angeles is still here. People are still going to work and going to movies and going on dates. And everybody's living their lives as usual. Now we cut back to the story, which is supposed to be a tough, tense police thriller. And now the filmmakers have to ramp up the tension again because they let it dissipate with that drone shot. The same happens. I'm not picking on these shows, but I know for a fact that because I've watched them, they do this. Yellowstone did this a lot. Kevin Costner in the dining room eating dinner, and somebody comes in and they have a blah, 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 and they start to fight and there's a tense dialogue scene, and then they cut to a drone shot of his ranch. Okay, well, that says, well, life goes on, you know, the ranch is still here, everything's okay. Now we go back, we have to ramp up more tension again because it was dissipated. Of course, the filmmaker doesn't intend that. What they're thinking is, I got 5, 6, 7 fairly static dialogue scenes in there. I got to break them up with something, so let's just stick a drone shot in there. But it does have an effect, and it has a cumulative effect. It's a death by 1,000 cuts, and it drains the story of its momentum. Every time you cut, you make a statement, an emotional statement. You create an emotional response in the audience's mind, whether you intended to or not. So it's best to intend to. You want to see the opposite of that, of those drone shots? Watch how Alfred Hitchcock used a extreme overhead shot. Obviously, there were no drones in 1962 when he shot this scene from The Birds.
Look.
They're attacking again.
Well, Melanie, you stay in here.
Come on, Al.
Look at the gas. That man's lighting a cigar.
Hey, you! Mr. Jack! Don't drop that match! Look out! Get out of there!
Mr. Ron!
Watch out! Look out! Look out! Watch out!
Notice how he used that high-angle shot for tremendous dramatic effect. Yes, these people down on the ground are struggling to just function with their, you know, denied their normal, their normal way of life, and catastrophe is beginning to happen. But up here, up high, where the birds are, they're just watching it and enjoying it and preparing for the next attack. And so that cut to an overhead shot had purpose and power and meaning and intent. It was designed that way. Let's sum this up by going back to that bar scene that we talked about, that I described both as a theatrical scene and as a cinematic scene, and just look at some of the techniques. By no means did I use all of them, but some of the techniques that we just described, how they were used. So the first one was, the camera does not have to be inside the stupid bar. It can be out in the street. I can start with an exterior if I so choose to. I could use dialogue to establish that one character's gay and one character's straight and that they're single, but I didn't have to. I have found a way to do it visually if I wish to do that. I can put the camera anywhere I want so the camera can look at whatever, focus on whatever I want the audience to look at, myself and the director, of course. I use depth of field, right? They go inside the bar, and I can just describe briefly in the script that there's a good-looking guy sitting in the background at the bar, and the director can frame the shot in such a way so that we can see them all in one shot, depth of field, and that creates tension. She's trying to attract the attention of that guy in the background. I can move the camera anywhere I want, close or far, and I did that when I cut to an extreme close-up of a cocktail waitress's tray as she carries two frilly-looking, frou-frou-y kind of drinks to their table. And I used the cut, finally, to complete the scene. I cut to exterior of the bar, and I showed the two men walking out, and then I showed the woman walking out. So I use as many of the cinematic techniques as I possibly could to make it as much like a film scene as I could and as little like a theatrical scene as I could. And again, the shorthand of it is, in theater, we have to motivate the characters on stage to begin talking, and in film, we're trying to motivate the characters to shut up and get going. We're talking more about how you attack scenes visually, how we use subtext, dramatic conflict, a lot more coming up next.